How's everybody doing? Enjoying the conference? Oh, come on. You can be more excited than that. So this is my first time in Italy or Europe at all, and it's been really, really cool. So I just want to thank everyone that's here for making this possible, and I've really enjoyed everyone here, meeting them, hanging out, and the country. And I'm going to start this off with doing a selfie of the room so we can tweet it later. All right, so everybody, smile. Oh, this is too many people. All right. So today we'll be talking about modern PHP standards and community. The idea is to walk through what's changed in the past few years with PHP. Well, I should go back several years because PHP changes pretty slowly. And then some of the new community initiatives and standards that are out there and available for you to use, how that helps you as a developer, things like that. Some things we'll cover, I'm sure a lot of you already know about. Some things will hopefully be new to you. But there's always a couple of people in the room that some of the older stuff either is new or they're not using it yet. So bear with me through some of the older things like PDO, as I encourage people to use that for people that aren't. Am I speaking too fast? Should I slow down or is it good? Thumbs up, down, up, cool. All right, so I am Ben Edmunds. You can find me at Ben Edmunds on Twitter or benedmunds.com. And if you want to like sync up after this, if you have a question you didn't get to ask, or even if you just want to talk about, you know, some nerdy shit, feel free to hit me up. I do a lot of PHP and Node especially, so either one of those I'm happy to talk about. I do some open source work, mainly around the CodeIgniter PHP framework. I'm on a couple of their boards, their security team, and then I also do the IonAuth package, which is an authentication package for CodeIgniter. I have a couple books, which I will give you a link to at the end, which is about securing PHP. And then I'm the CTO at Mindfulware. We do insurance and medical software. And I do the PHP Town Hall podcast. So if you've ever seen that, it's the one with the, until recently, had the angry British guy, Phil Sturgeon, and me trying to contain him. And recently, Amanda Folsom has joined to replace Phil. So check it out if you haven't. All right, let's get started. We're going to walk through a few things, and I'm just going to tell you like when they came to be and you know what we're going to be covering. So first off is exceptions. I'm sorry, I had bad eyesight. All right. So exceptions were added in PHP 5, but then in PHP 7, some changes were made to the way those were handled. And so you have the new throwable class that exceptions extend. We'll walk through a little bit about how that works and where the changes are there. Then we'll also cover PDO. That was added in 5.1. So it's been out for a very long time. But why you should use PDO, what it helps you with, things like that. I still routinely see projects and teams that aren't using PDO. They're still using the MySQL drivers or maybe the Postgres drivers. So I want to briefly hit on that and show you why you really need to be using PDO. Welcome to 2017. We'll cover closures a little bit, kind of what their uses are, where they're abused, and just so you're familiar with the syntax. Some of the stuff I want to walk through isn't really anything crazy new. It's just I want you to be familiar with the syntax, because as you get more involved in the community and new open source projects, you'll see the syntax around. Namespaces is kind of the same thing. What is it good for? What's the syntax look like? Then the short array syntax. We'll cover traits, which is new in 5.4. And then some of the new 7 stuff we'll also briefly cover. So no coalescing operator, scalar type hints, and return type declarations. And then we'll also go through some of the tools available to us now in PHP. We have a built-in web server. We have Composer for dependency management. And then also our unit testing capabilities have really expanded in the past few years. And then standards. So I want to walk through some of the PHP fig and the PSRs they put out. what the purpose of the fig is and what some of the main PSRs are, so that you know them when you see them in the wild, and then maybe you want to even think about bringing your team over to them. And we'll end with how to get involved in the community. All right, so let's jump in. We'll start with exceptions. So you might hate the idea of exceptions, but they're actually a good thing. It's not always a bad thing. The idea of an exception is, instead of just executing the code and trying to guess what an error state is, so maybe you're using a library you've never used before. So if you want to catch that that library made a mistake or something went wrong, you might, in the old days, have to look up their docs and see, okay, so if this doesn't work, it returns false. Or maybe if this doesn't work, it returns -1. If this doesn't work right, it returns some message or some whatever thing it might return, right? Exceptions give us a nice, clean way to do this the same across all the libraries we use across our project. So what we're going to do is we're going to try to do something, and code goes here for what you're trying to do. And then if that code fails, we're going to catch it as an exception. And what's happening inside that code is it's saying, okay, I found an error, I'm going to throw an exception. And that tells your code to go grab it, and we do something with it here. That's what we're catching. So the basic method you have on there is getMessage. I'd recommend you check the docs to see what other methods you have, but getMessage will just give you the what other message was returned when that error exception was thrown. A change that was done in PHP 7 is that now both exception and error implement the throwable class. And so throwable gives you a clean way to catch both of those. So what you could do is you could just catch errors, you could catch exceptions, you could catch both. So you could say, if this is an error, let's catch it. If this is an exception, let's catch it and do something different with it, so you can separate out your logic. This is really great for, like, maybe an exception means, oh, you're not authorized to do this. Maybe an error means you gave me a bad parameter. You can separate out what's going to happen there. You can also extend, say you extend the exception class and you make your own authentication failed exception. You can catch that exact exception. So it doesn't have to be generic. You can get as detailed as you want with this. Also, let's say you extend the exception for that authentication exception. If you caught exception itself, you would catch both of those. But if you just catch authentication exception, you would catch that one, because the off exception would extend the general exception. And then if you want to just catch everything ever, throwable now in PHP 7 is a great way to do that, because they both extend it. So we just want to catch anything that goes wrong, we catch throwable, and you'll end up there. All right, PDO. So I like to give MongoDB a hard time just because they had so many data issues years ago. It's fine now, I promise. So PDO is a cross-system way of handling your databases. It abstracts away your database interactions. If you've used like MySQL or the Postgres extensions for PHP, it's basically the same thing, but it's going to give you a standard abstraction to do both of those or to do many other databases. You can interact with all these databases through the same API, through the same library, and it makes it easier to be cross-system. So let's say you decide to change from MySQL to Postgres at some point. It makes it much easier to do that. Also, if you're putting a library out, so let's say like you're actually contributing open source, you put a library out, if you use PDO, it makes it easier for people to consume that library, to use it, no matter what database system they're using. So like you could put out whatever library you want, and then I, as a user, could go use that if I'm on MySQL. Another user could use it if they're on Postgres. It won't matter, because PDO is handling all that for you. Another thing it helps with is safe binding. So I'm pretty sure a lot of this has hit the case before with MySQL, where we are passing data into the database and we didn't escape it properly, and then all of a sudden we have an injection attack. Right? That's not a place you want to be. You don't want to get that call that your site's been hacked. It's not that you can't do this with the old way. You can manually escape everything with the MySQL extension, but it's a lot easier through PDO, and PDO just kind of does it automatically. So let's see what that looks like. With PDO, we're going to make a prepared statement. So we're going to do statement equals db prepare, and then here we're throwing it a query. So note in that query, though, that colon ID, that's a special thing saying, hey, we're going to put a variable in here. And then we're going to bind a param to that variable. So we're binding the colon ID to our actual ID field, and then we're executing that statement. What this does is this automatically escapes it for us, and it makes sure that that data is safe. All right, closures. All right, so what this is it's an anonymous function that can also use data. So here we're going to pass through an unnamed function to this. So we have route_get. Route_get is just a static method call. The first parameter is a forward slash. So this is I believe this example is from Laravel, but it's kind of your generic routing example. So anything that goes to the forward slash URL, then we're going to run this function for it. And in this function, we're just returning a new view, whatever, the index view. It doesn't really matter. But what you really want to look at is the function declaration. And notice that it's not named. So we're not saying, like, function return my view index. We're just throwing in an anonymous function. Another thing you can do with this is you can add a use after the function declaration, so function and then use. And then you can set the variables that you want to use inside that function. So not only can you encapsulate your logic inside that function, you can also access variables that are external to it. So I do want to caveat, though, a lot of times when people see this, maybe they're used to it from JavaScript, or maybe it's just a new thing that looks cool. But keep in mind, it can be abused. This is a one-time use function. So unless you are doing it inside something greater that's easy to call, keep in mind, you're not going to be able to call this function again later. So that means you're not going to be able to be dry. That means you're not going to be able to reuse this code a lot because it's, again, a one-time use function. Keep that in mind. All right. Namespaces allow you to encapsulate your logic for your libraries or for whatever you're doing into kind of neat spaces. Just keep it safe and isolated from the rest of your app. So here what we have is we're defining a namespace, illuminate console, and then we're defining a class inside that namespace with command. So this command class lives completely inside this namespace. If we were outside this namespace, we're just in whatever, we make a new PHP file, and we try to call the command class, we try to initiate a new command, it's not going to work because we are not in that namespace. So this doesn't go to global space, it's just encapsulated here. The way we do that is we use illuminate console command. So if I want to use that, I use illuminate console command, and then I can do my command variable equals new command. This is really great for large apps, also if you're using a lot of libraries. So if you're using a couple of libraries, it's very easy for them to have the same class names. Like command, for example, is a very generic class name. Without the namespaces, it would be really easy to hit a collision. So like library A I'm using and framework B I'm using both have a command class, and then we're throwing errors because they're violating each other's space in the global space. But since we're namespacing, that won't happen. We'll be able to define where we want to use it. All right, short array syntax. This is probably most familiar to you from JavaScript. For most PHP developers, we also end up doing some type of JavaScript on the front end at some point. In the past, we wrote arrays out like this. So array equals array, 0, 1 value, right? Now there's a shorter way to do that with just a square bracket. Doesn't really add any other functionality except say they use some keystrokes, making it a little easier to type this out and to see. Also makes it easier to find this in line, or cleaner. I wouldn't say easier. Traits. So traits are grouping without strict inheritance. So we're used to classes inheriting their parent classes. So if I extend from before, if auth exception extends exception, it's going to get everything within exception, including its state. So traits won't do that. So here, I'm just going to give you an example because it's a lot easier to conceptualize if you see it. We're creating a new trait, base user. Then we're defining a method on that, saying getName. And that getName is just going to return a string in this case. But that would probably be from your database or from your session or whatever, right? So here, we're going to define an admin user class. Admin user doesn't extend base user. It's just going to use base user. So what that basically does is it takes all the methods from the base user and just drops them into that admin user without any inheritance. And then if we want to use that, we can define a new admin user, and then we can echo admin user getName. All right, so notice here, we never defined a getName function on the admin user. It was defined on the base user trait. But here, we can call getName on the admin user. Cool, make sense? All right, a couple of you look a little confused. Let's walk through that one more time. So we're defining a trait of base user. So this is our base user trait. And then our admin user is going to use that. And this doesn't carry over into state. So let's say we have, we can have another user. We can have the generic user. It could also use that base user. We have multiple user types. None of those would share state between them, but they would all inherit the parent methods. So in this case, we just define a new admin user. It's inheriting the base user's methods. I used the wrong word. It's pulling in. It's using the base user's methods. And then we're able to use that on the admin user. It can get a little confusing, like when you should do this versus when you should inherit. That's kind of up to you in your use case. It's obviously, we haven't added it until recently, so it's not like you needed it to build an app at all. It's not like it was a make or break thing. But it does help in a lot of cases. Usually when you just want to kind of throw stuff around, and you're not trying to build out this huge object relational model, you really just need to reuse some functions or some methods. Another thing that was added in PHP 5.5 was some utility functions to help you with passwords and hashing. So we had the new password hash function that takes in a string. So in this case, the example, we're just using a post variable of pass. And then it takes a second argument of the algo you want to use. So there's a couple constants defined within PHP. You can do like password underscore default. You can do password underscore bcrypt to set the algo. Then there's also a function password verify for verifying your passwords. And that takes in a string for your password and then your previously used hash. So that'll usually be the hash you saved in the database. And then one final function, password needs rehash. That takes in your hash from your database, and then the algo you want to use. All right, so let's look at this in detail so you can really see what's going on here. So this is an example that kind of shows them all. So here we're saying if the password is verified, so we have the user, they submit a form with their password, so it's the normal login form. Here we're taking their post pass as their variable, and then we're comparing it against the password hash that was stored in the database. If that passes, we'll go inside that if. All right, so now we check if password needs rehash. So this is a really cool thing. One problem you hit a lot is, like, let's say I have an app I did 10 years ago. I used MD5 because MD5 is what was popular back then. Now MD5 has been broken, and I need to migrate all my users to something newer. There's several options for that. There's a lot of ways to do it, but they all kind of suck. Some of them mean you have to get your users to actually go reset all their passwords at once. So, like, I just go through and I clear out all my old MD5 hashes, and I tell my users, all right, you got to go set a new password. You got to go through the forgotten password loop kind of thing, right? That's not a good user experience. Another option is that you wait until the user next logs in, and then now we have the password string, so we can just rehash it. That's what this follows through. That's a little better. This is pretty good. The problem is then you can end up with still pretty old hashes in your database that are vulnerable. Another option is, let's say we just loop through and we rehash the MD5s on our newer scheme. So maybe we bcrypt the MD5 hashes. That's going to be slower. That's probably the easiest user experience. One great way to handle this, though, is to think about it a little earlier on with an example like this. So if we do this, it's going to just be constantly updating our passwords as we go through. So as those standards change, Like right now, the PHP default is bcrypt. That's kind of the accepted standard across the industry. But at some point, bcrypt will be obsolete and will move up to something else. So if you do this, it'll automatically keep rehashing those passwords as users log in. All right, so we did password verify. We made sure they had a good password. Then our password needs rehash. This is going to check the password hash from the database against the default in PHP to see if they line up. So like right now, that's bcrypt. And later on, that changes, it'll change. All right, so if that does need a rehash, then we're going to go inside that next if, and we're going to go ahead and rehash that password against the new default, and we're going to store that in the database. So you can pretty easily imagine, too, like what a new user registration looks like. So it's basically just without these first two ifs, and you're just in here. So you're just going to take the password they send you on the registration form, and you're going to hash it, and then you're going to store it in the database. So for those who don't know, a hash is a one-way hash in this case. So the idea is that there should be no way for you to get the plain text string of the user's password back. Bcrypt will take that plain text string, it will take a salt, it will do a lot of magic, and it will give you a hash at the end, a hash that can't be reversed. Cool? All right, we also have the null coalescing operator. This is another just kind of utility function to save you time. In the past, you had to do this if you were doing a ternary. So we would say, all right, so maybe we're in a view and we want to display something. We'd say, if this is set, then use it, else use this default. I'm sure we've all done that like a million times. Now with null coalescing, we can just do this. So this double question mark tells your program, if the value is set, use it, otherwise fall back to this default. This comes in really handy in views or in defining data you want to pass to views. All right, now let's walk through some of the new type options in PHP 2. So now with PHP 7, we have scalar type hinting. It's kind of like a aggressive name. It feels intimidating, right? But it's really not that complex. What it does is if you add this declare strict types equals 1 at the top of your file, then we're going to turn on the strict typing for the remainder of this file. So just note that. You can't just put this at like one place ever. Like let's say you have a library. You can't just put this on your library and assume it's going to work in the rest of the app. But if you do put it in the app, it will go down because it's about what's executed within that file. All right, so here's an example. We have a function named addNums, so it's adding two numbers together. And then we have an A and a B parameter for that. Note that we're adding the float before the A and a float before the B. So that means that we expect the parameters you pass into this function to be floats. And then we're just returning back the addition of those two. If we try to pass in, say, like a 2, which is an integer, which also passes for a float in PHP, and then we try to pass in a string of the 1 week, this is now going to throw a fatal error. So it's yet another way to catch errors in your programs. Usually what PHP would do without strict types is it would try to cast that 1 week string to an integer. So in this case, it would probably be a 1. So you would probably end up with 3 as your output and have no idea that you actually gave it bad input. All right, another thing to note there is just the fatal error. So that's also an error you could catch. So you could have this in a try-catch block and catch that fatal error. Like that. All right, and then if you use it properly with both being integers, then we'll try to catch it. It won't catch anything because it passed, and then we'll get an output of 3. There's several types supported for this. I don't know if this has changed any in the recent minor versions, but this is what came out with 7. So you have classes, arrays, callables, bools, floats, ints, and strings. All right, we also have the return type declarations, which these two together give you a lot of power for catching type issues. So here, we're already used to the float A, float B we have, but then we also have this new colon float after the function declaration. So this says that we expect what is returned from this to be a float as well. So not only are we checking the inputs, we're checking the output. All right, so here we're trying to pass in a 1.5 and a 1. So note, here was float, but now I'm changing it to int just to show you the example. So we're expecting the output of this to be an int. We're passing in a 1.5, which is okay, because we are not checking what we bring in. But here we're returning a plus b, which is not going to work, because our output would be 2.5, and that's going to throw an error. It's a fatal error, because the return value is an integer. It's not an integer, it's a float. Cool? So if you combine those two together, if you combine checking your inputs and your outputs, you can be sure that not only are your functions taking in the correct data, they're also outputting the correct data. It's just a really good additional check to catch things before you get to your test or before you get to your users. All right, let's cover some of the tools we have available in PHP now. So for the longest time, PHP kind of sucked in this arena, right? All the cool kids in Ruby, they got the great tools. Maybe, whatever, C++ had some really good tools. PHP just kind of lagged behind for a long time. We just had to do it all ourselves. But now there's some really good tools built in and available from the community. One of those is the built-in web server. So here, just from the command line, you can run php-s and then define your domain and your port, and it will run that folder that you're in a local web server. You don't need Apache, you don't need Nginx, whatever. It'll just start up a server for you, and then you can access it from your browser at localhost/8000. This is really cool for, like, if you have a lot of projects you jump between, or if you do any kind of consulting work where you're in and out of a lot of projects all day, this is really nice for that. Because you don't have to set up like a million virtual hosts or anything like that. You just jump into the project folder and you run your server. All right, Composer we have to cover. Who here uses Composer? Show of hands. Okay, cool. I'm glad. Glad to see that. So Composer is a very sane way to handle package management in PHP. It has auto-loading available through PSR4, which we'll walk through a little bit. So not only do you have a central place to handle, to use a format for your libraries, you can also automatically load them into your app. So if you ever use Pair, please don't even like associate the two, because Pair was horrible in pretty much every way. Composer's awesome. If you want to check out some of the packages available for this, check out packages.org. So Composer itself is just a way to handle the packages. Packages is a central repository for packages. So you'll go to Packages to get Composer packages. It's a little hard to voice, right? All right, so what this looks like is you're going to create a composer.json file at the root of your project. And then inside that, we're defining JSON for what libraries we're going to use. We can also define versions in there. And so in this case, we're defining Stripe and Twilio. And then we're just going to use Debmaster for these. You can also do like a require dev. So maybe you use a newer version in dev, or you use PHP unit in dev, but you don't use PHP unit in prod, things like that. So you do have a lot of options there. This does a couple things for you. It's going to make sure that everyone on your team is using the same versions of the software. It'll also let you lock this in. So let's say we get a version to production. We don't want the next update of Twilio to break our production app because they decided to update something. We want to make sure our production app is set in stone. The way we do that is through the Composer lock. So we define this Composer JSON file, and then we're going to run Composer install, and that's going to generate Composer lock. So what it does, it goes through, it downloads all the files to a vendor folder, and then it's going to say the exact versions it used into that lock file. So I added this today for Niles. Commit your lock files, please. So what committing your lock file allows you to do is it allows you to set in stone this is the version we're using. And then on your servers or the other people on your team can make sure they're using those same versions. I've hit a million times where, oh, I'm seeing something different than somebody else on my team, or, oh, it works fine for me on my machine, right? But the server is down. And a lot of times that comes down to, oh, but this thing I'm using is a different version than it is on the server. The lock file gives you an easy way to make sure you're all in sync. the way you use that is, let's say I pull down a Git repo that has a composer lock file. I can just run composer install, and it's going to install the exact versions that are in that lock. So let's say, though, there is a new version, and I want to update my lock file to use the newest version of the Twilio library. I can run composer update, and update will go look in the JSON file, go find the newest versions or the versions that match my JSON file, and then update and install a new composer lock file. So that's the way you update your dependencies. The way this looks like, so with auto-loading, I have this all defined, and then I can just do client equals new services Twilio, and it's going to automatically go find that library for me, and it's going to require the class in, and then I can just use it. I don't have to worry about managing the paths or trying to require once, require, whatever. It handles it. All right. Let's cover unit testing just a little bit. So we have a lot of options in PHP for unit testing now, which is really good to see, because for a long time, PHP in general just kind of ignored testing. But in the past few years, it's really gotten a lot of the excitement around it. Testing allows you to make sure your code works how you expect before your user finds a bug, or before you have bad data integrity. So what this looks like with a very basic example, we're going to do, we're just doing an API auth test, right? So we're just making sure the API works. We're extending the PHP unit class, and then we're defining a test verify method. And then we're just going to say auth equals new API auth, whatever that is. It doesn't really matter. It's just an example. And then we're going to assert true that auth verified. So the things to note here is the class itself, and then the assert true. So assert true says make sure that the response inside this is true. There's a lot of ways you can use this, but here we're saying make sure that we can verify our authentication. What that looks like when you run it, so you just do PHP unit test from your command line by default. Also, if you're using a framework, a lot of times they'll have their own way to do this, like PHP Artisan has its own way of running its test suite. And then the output from that is down here at the bottom. So we ran the test is there, and then the output was okay. So we had one test and one assertion. All right, some of the standards that are new to PHP. We have the PHP FIG, which is the Framework Interop Group. They recently went through also a new kind of overhaul for FIG 3.0, and it changes the way they handle the groupings, and they kind of like split out into smaller groups and working groups, really both to encourage people to contribute more, so it's not as big of a deal to be involved. You don't have to keep track of every single thing happening in the FIG. You can just care about your own one thing. And then also really just to kind of encourage people to collaborate and to be more the smaller team so that you can get more done. They hit a problem at some point where they weren't getting as much done. But basically what the FIG does is they put out these standard recommendations. This is what we think is best. This is how we think you should do something. So for example, the auto-loading. They put out a standard that said this is how we think you should do auto-loading. And then we have a bunch of member projects, which are like frameworks that are popular, libraries that are popular, that get behind this and say, all right, so we're all going to recommend this, or we're all going to use this in our frameworks to help PHP as a whole interoperate better. So if you use two different frameworks that both use PSR4, you can autoload libraries, like between Cake and Joomla, or Cake and Laravel, or whatever, in the same way. You don't have to go read their docs and learn how they do it. They're all doing it the same way. Some of the popular member projects, and these change pretty often, Xen, Symfony, Cake, Magento, Joomla, Drupal. There's a ton more. Also, note that some projects use the PSRs without actually being member projects. So member projects just means you're a regular contributor. But like Laravel uses PSR4, but it's not actually a member project anymore. And again, they're standards recommendations. This isn't official PHP. This isn't something you have to use. But it's the community getting together and saying, hey, we recommend doing it this way. Some of the more popular ones are the auto-loading interfaces and the style guides. So like there's PSR 1 and 2, which say, hey, we're going to use spacing this way. We're not going to use tabs. We're going to put brackets here things like that, just to give you a general style that is good across frameworks, across apps. If you've worked at any decent-sized company, you've probably went through the pain of trying to set up your own style guide. Because if you're jumping from project to project, maybe developer B worked on this before, now developer A's on it, and they use completely different styles, not only does the code get really messy really quickly, but it's also it's hard to understand. So if I come in as a new developer and there's two different styles in the same project, it can be hard to follow. The same thing holds true for if you're jumping across frameworks or across apps, and the PSRs try to fix that. So not only do we have like a style guide for the company, we now have a style guide for the PHP community as a whole. All right, briefly, some of the PSRs that are popular. We have auto-loading, some basic coding standards with PSR1, some basic style guides with PSR2. And these are all fairly basic. They're not going to get crazy in-depth on how you have to do everything, but the basics are covered. PSR7, which is HTTP messages, PSR6, which is caching, and then PSR3, which is logging. Four is the one I want to kind of impress on you most because it's the one you're most likely to see. The others are very important, but four also replaces PSR0. So 0 came out years ago, and then they found some problems with it, so they put out 4 to fix those problems with 0. For the most part, it's backwards compatible, too. And then it's used by Composer, which I showed you before. It's also used by probably most frameworks you use. And again, what that looks like for the auto-loading is just that. You don't have to worry about finding the path, figuring out where it is. It just works. PSR1, basic styles. It's generally accepted across most projects. You won't see too many issues with PSR1. It's not very opinionated. It's very generic. PSR1 covers camel casing, opening tags, namespacing, class names, UTF-8. So it's really generic things of how do we capitalize, where do we put the tags, things like that. PSR2 goes into a lot more detail. It's a lot more opinionated. And because of that, it has a lot more people that don't like it. So a lot of frameworks won't use PSR2, or they'll use PSR2, and then they'll add some changes on top. Again, for the most part, I like it. One thing that was hard for me is it defines spaces instead of tabs, and I was always a tabs guy. I know that's like a holy war for developers. But I've switched to spaces just because of this, because it's best to have your projects work as easily as possible to be as easy for people to pick up as you can. So end of the day, it's not a huge deal, and it's worth being in the same standard, the same format as the rest of the community. So it covers spacing, braces, lines. So like, do I put the brace on this line? Do I put the brace on the next line? Do I add a space after this? Do I add a new line after that? And then keywords, bools. So like, are bools capital or lowercase, etc. And then control structures. So how do I define an if? Where do I put the brackets on the if? Where does my else go? Things like that. PSR7 for messages is just request and response. So it tries to really just define what this looks like. So let's say I jump from two projects that use PSR7, and that means that they're both probably going to use pretty similar routing logic. And by default, I should know how to interact with a route or with a view response, etc., because they match up. All right, a brief introduction to the community of PHP. Conferences are amazing. They're a great way to get involved. I'm really happy to see you all here. But the community doesn't stop when you leave the conference. So I want to make sure that you know resources, you know where to go, and that you're encouraged to interact with that. The PHP community is really one of the most open and inviting communities I've been a part of. Out of all the languages, all the frameworks, PHP, they'll just invite you in, and there's no clicks. It's just you're a part of the community. Let's get things done. A few really good ways to get involved with the greater PHP community online is PHPC. There's a Twitter. There's also an IRC if you're into that. Cal Evans has a really good list of PHP people he recommends you follow. And then through your framework or project. So if there's a framework you use a lot, if there's a project you use a lot that you're passionate about, seek them out. See where they're hanging out. It's probably IRC or Slack or something like that. But feel free to just jump in, answer some questions, ask some questions. You shouldn't feel intimidated to get involved. Everyone starts somewhere. Everyone asks a dumb question. I ask dumb questions all the time, right? There's also things you can help with. So there's going to be someone in that chat room that knows less than you know asking a question you've already solved, and you can help them with that. You don't have to be some guru with the framework and know it all to contribute and to be a part. A way to stay involved with what's happening with PHP itself is the PHP.NET mailing list. So if you want to keep track of what changes are coming for PHP, what code updates there are, etc. And then IRC in general, on Freenode, there's PHPC, and there's also PHP. PHP ends up being more like a support request, people having questions. PHPC kind of just says no support requests at all. It's just about the community just hanging out. A few blogs that are good, PlanetPHP, PHP Architects. And then podcasts are a great place just to get involved and hear what's going on. The Voices of the Elephant, the PHP Roundtable is really cool. Sammy K just gets like a bunch of people together and just kind of like a small party. So it is round table, right? But it's not always in person. But it'll be 5 to 10 people a lot of times. It's just a fun time. And then also there's my podcast, PHP Town Hall, which would be cool if you check it out. And also your local user group. So even after the conference is over, there's local user groups that usually meet at least once a month. I don't know what your user group here is. If there's not one in Verona, there will probably be one in the next largest city. And just get involved with that. Just go hang out. Maybe give a talk. So if you're interested in speaking at a conference, user groups are a great place to get started. It's a smaller crowd. Everyone's a lot more understanding. User group organizers are always looking for speakers. Because you have to put this thing on 12 times a year, maybe 24 times a year, you run out of speakers for that. So if you want to give a talk, just go talk to your organizer at your local user group. They would love to have you. They'll usually also help you craft the talk. So maybe you're intimidated or maybe it's your first one. Go talk to the organizer and see if they'll help you with that. I don't know what your user group is here, but I'm sure you have one. And then conferences are great. A couple things to note about conferences, though. Like, it all doesn't happen in these rooms. It also happens out in the hallway. It happens at dinner. It happens at drinks. That's where you're going to make some of the bigger connections. I've actually made some of my best friends from conferences. So don't feel like you have to just sit in every session, Ethan. It's okay to skip a session if you're having a great conversation in the hallway. A lot of times you'll learn more in-depth information. You'll make friends. You'll get involved from the hallway. So the idea of the talks usually is to really give you a spark of an idea, to intrigue you, to give you something new, to get you interested in checking something out. And then you go out of this room and you learn more about it and you get more in depth and you get excited about it. All right. How much time do we have? Yeah, we're good. Okay, so some questions? 6? Okay. So we'll take like 1 or 2. I have more slides after this. All right, any questions from anybody? It could be about anything. Yep. Yeah.